All right, geology. Geology? Yes. Geology. This is Mini Geology, the radio program from KPFT HD2 channel in Houston. Hello everybody, this is Daniel Minizini, your inquisitive geologist here at KPFT Houston. Today we have with us John Anderson, a thought leader in applying marine geology to sedimentological problems of societal importance. So, John, welcome to Mini Geology.
Thank you, Daniel. Pleasure to be here.
John, you just retired officially from Rice University. How would you define yourself as a geologist?
Well, I guess as a geologist, my main interest, as you point out, is in the sedimentary record of not only Earth's past, which is what most people think about geologists doing, looking at sediments and reinterpreting Earth's history, or interpreting Earth's history. And I certainly enjoy doing that. We all do. That's the fun part of geology, is, you know, driving down the highway, looking at the rocks, and being able to get out of the car and look at the rocks and say, well, there was a beach here, and it was here 40 million years ago, and the beach, you know, looked like this. But there's another part that most people don't really think about, and that's being able to take what we learn from the past and apply it to the future. And that's something that I really enjoy a lot. I think in this day and time, it also is very important, because geologists have the advantage of tweaking a time machine, the geological time machine, and looking back thousands of years, which is a time period that's very important in trying to understand some of the changes that we're facing today due to global change.
So, in a way, you are not only studying the classical geology in the rocks, which imply deep time, but also the modern systems, what we would call the marine geology?
That's correct. Yeah, I think, again, new in the last 20 years of my career, which represents about half my career, I think there has been this trend towards more and more geologists beginning to look not just at the past, but look at the current situation and look at the future, try to predict the future based on what we're able to say about the past using the rock record as a sedimentary record.
So today we're going to talk with John about three main topics. I would like to bring in to you his great experience because John has studied geology for almost 50 years, actually 50 years collecting data, analyzing them. He had more than 60 in between master and PhD students. You probably know he has hundreds of publications, and he certainly collaborated with a lot of professionals, not only academics, but also in the industry, policymakers. So I would like to bring to you his experience, asking him questions about the big systems, about the research and the methods and the goals of research, but then going down into his main objects of studies, which are Antarctica and the coast of the Gulf of Mexico. Finally, I would like to ask him some questions about his human side as a scientist. So let's start, John, from you. Do you feel be more a professor or a researcher?
Well, I guess both. It's hard to separate the two because, you know, I firmly feel that it's hard to be a professor if you're not a researcher. I mean, we're expected to increase the knowledge of our students, especially graduates and undergraduate students. It's hard to do that with books alone and working with knowledge that's already printed.
I remember one of my professors telling me there's no book good enough without a professor. There's not a professor good enough without a book.
That's right. That's right.
So, and so from the height of your career, what do you think are the methods that you use in your research? And I ask you this because methods, as well as the goals of the research, they should be shared within the geological community, and the geological community should agree with those. So I would like to ask you your point of view on the methods in the goals that you apply in your career?
Well, I guess I'm not much of a methods guy. I mean, I think geologists, you know, there are a lot of my colleagues and friends in the field are very much focused on methodology, and that's important because we have to continue to develop new methods. If we don't do that, then, you know, the science gets stale. I'm more of a application kind of guy, and I'm one of these folks that scientists that sit back and wait on new applications to be developed, new tools, new equipment, new instrumentation that enable me to solve problems. And the longer you've been in the field, and I've been in the field a long time, the more you begin to realize that, you know, there's a lot of low-hanging fruit, especially if you work in a place like Antarctica, where as new tools are made available for mapping the seafloor, for example, it creates great opportunities to go in and solve problems that were on the shelf for decades that we couldn't solve because we didn't have the capability, for example, to map the seafloor in great precision or to date sediments using different types of radiocarbon dating and things that weren't around 15, 20 years ago.
But so what do you do with those low-hanging fruits?
Well, it's not, I don't want to come off sounding like we just wait on a new tool to come along and go out and find a way to apply it. There's always lots of problems, and especially if you work, again, in a place like Antarctica and things that you really want, questions that need to be addressed, questions that need to be resolved. You know, how's the ice sheet, current ice sheet behavior? Is it unique, or has the ice sheet always behaved in the same manner? Sometimes those questions depend upon collecting data that we just may not have the proper instrumentation to acquire that data. And so if you stick around long enough, as I've done, new instrumentation comes along, and eventually something comes along that you say, well, I've been thinking about this problem for 20 years or trying, you know, a lot of us have been trying to solve this problem. And now there's this new equipment that's going to allow us to do this.
And do you think also that the new equipments, they help raising new questions, or the key questions, the important questions, they are there independently from the tools that you have in your toolbox?
Oh, there's no question, but getting the new instrumentation, it sort of feeds on itself, and then that brings up new problems. I'll give you a good example. I spent the first 30 years of my career working in Antarctica trying to understand the behavior of the ice sheet, you know, and particularly how it retreats and what causes it to retreat and how fast does it retreat and how fast does that result in sea level rise, things of that nature. And we began to realize 20 years ago that the interaction of the ice sheet and the bed on which it rests, the seafloor, was very critical in the behavior of the ice sheet, to the behavior of the ice sheet. But we were dealing with very crude tools for actually mapping the seafloor. So as time went along, about 10 years ago, they began to develop methods that enabled us to image features on the seafloor that were formed at the base of the ice sheet, what we sort of refer to sometimes as the death mask of the ice sheet or the footprint of the ice sheet. We began to realize that, you know, tools that were being developed were good enough to enable us to now see features on the seafloor that we couldn't even image before. Be like flying over a planet from a distant orbit and only able to image the, you know, the biggest, largest features. And now we could really begin to get down to the level of the kinds of features we might see if we were flying in an aircraft just 1,000 feet above the Earth's surface. And those are actually the features that we need to see to tell us what's happening under the ice. You know, is there running water there? And if so, is it channelized? You know, there are a lot of these kinds of questions. And so with this new tool, which is called multi-beam or swath bathymetry, that allows us to image, you know, the seafloor with resolution that enables us to see very small features, features of maybe a few feet in height. Suddenly a whole new world opened up to us when we were able to see in great detail. It's a little bit like planetary geology. You know, planetary geologists get more and more excited as they get closer and closer to planets and see features close. Well, it's not very different here on Earth when we're looking at the seafloor. We're just beginning to really be able to image portions of the seafloor that we just, you know, couldn't image in that level of detail before. And they're telling us a lot about, in this case, how ice sheets have behaved in the past.
So you really mean that once you have these new products with new tools, you come up with new set of questions?
Yeah, we answer, often hopefully can answer some of the questions we've been asking for 20 years. But then we realize, well, there are a whole lot of other questions, of course, that come from that. We say, okay, well, the ice, now we know the ice steps back, you know, rapidly over time spans of decades to centuries. And then the question is, but what's controlling that behavior? What's causing it to because in the past we thought it took much longer for these changes to occur. Now we realize, well, these changes are happening really quickly, even in the geological past. So what's driving it? And once you get into the mechanisms, the forcings, we call it, what causes the ice to behave that way and float off the seafloor and retreat, then that raises a whole set of additional questions.
Yeah, which is a secondary set of questions. But do you think that one of the most important things is the trigger? What is the trigger? What is causing this? What is the cause? What is the final cause? If we want to talk about the big system, is that the key question whenever you research?
Absolutely. I mean, I think that ultimately, if we want to understand why the ice sheet is behaving as it is today, not only Antarctica, but Greenland, we need to understand how it behaved in the past. And I think for these new tools have taught us that actually, now we can look at, we used to talk about the behavior of the ice sheet in millennial time, you know, processes that occurred over thousands of years. And now that we have these new tools, now we're talking about behavior over decades and centuries, which is getting it down to the time frames that we're actually observing today. And we began to observe, well, some ice, you know, portions of the ice sheet behave very rapidly, retreat very rapidly. Other portions tend to be quite stable. So why is one area stable and why is another area unstable? What's the driver here? What's causing it? And as we get into these investigations, and of course, my students and I aren't anywhere near qualified to answer a lot of these questions. We have to, you know, team up with other scientists. So we might read a paper or make some observations that tell us tides may be very important. We always underestimated the importance of tides in Antarctica because they're not very, you know, has a very low tidal range. But now that we have this increased ability to observe much finer scale behavior, suddenly we begin to realize, well, tides could actually be an important mechanism. So then we have to go seek out people who study tides in Antarctica or Greenland and other places and work with those people. So that's one of the exciting things about science is you're not only driven by new instrumentation, but that sort of forces you to seek out new expertise. People, you know, that maybe you would have never dreamed you'd be working with 10 years ago, and the next thing you know, you find, you know, one of your closest colleagues and allies is somebody working in a field that you know very little about.
How do those relationships generally develop? Are they positive, or sometimes you have to step back and say, that was not the right relationship, this kind of discipline is so far away from mine, or this kind of people that they study, they have a completely different mindset that is not really in the same wavelength than mine?
Well, I think that's what, you know, scientific societies are all about, right? And so we can kind of predetermine who the best person might be to interact with by, first of all, reading the literature, reading papers, and finding out, well, who's been publishing in this field. And then secondly, we go to conferences. And a lot of times people say, well, why do scientists fly all over the world to go to conferences? And one of the big reasons for that is to actually get to know, personally get to know the people that you think you may be interacting with in the future to try to solve a specific problem. So if you look at, if you know, you attend a scientific conference, you see people and they're all kind of teaming up and they're talking, and lots of time these are people who haven't talked before. They're taking advantage of that opportunity to go to a place and meet with other scientists and see if they might have mutual interest in trying to solve a very important scientific problem.
Do you think that some of the teams that they publish on specific topics, for instance, the ones studying, analyzing, and publishing on tides, do you think that they write in order to gain attention from other communities so that the other groups, they go and interact with them, or this is just pure serendipity?
Well, no, I think there's always a motivation, I mean, behind writing. I mean, I was always told when I got started, publisher perish, and I used to think, well, if that's all it's all about, that doesn't sound too exciting. I don't think most scientists publish papers to avoid perishing. We publish papers because we do science. That's what we do. It's like an artist who paints. And publishing that paper is like an artist exhibiting that work of art. It's the same for us. We take a great deal of pride and satisfaction out of publishing a paper and having colleagues write us and say, good paper. Sometimes they say bad paper. But it's an opportunity to really kind of, you know, get our works out there, get other people to look at it, and hopefully other people get interest. And again, that sort of that hopefully sparks some collaboration with other scientists that leads to bigger things.
John, you mentioned at the very beginning that you are not the method kind of guy. You are more the applied guy. So can you talk about the application of the research that you do, or the research that you did?
Yeah, being a marine geologist, somebody that goes to sea, you know, and spends a lot of time on ships, and especially in a place like Antarctica, you know, when you go on a cruise to Antarctica, it's very costly. You're away from your family, so there's a personal sacrifice. So there's always this feeling of wanting to optimize your time there. So the first thing to make sure that happens is you've got good problems to solve. And that's usually taken care of up front, because you don't get funding from the National Science Foundation to have an expedition to Antarctica unless you've written a proposal that's gone through the peer system and been reviewed by your colleagues. So you've sold the idea, you've sold the problem before you leave. But then the next bigger part is actually going on the ship to this remote part of the world, making sure you've got the right equipment, the right instrumentation to solve that problem, and making sure that equipment's functioning properly. So that means having the right people to maintain the equipment. It's a big challenge and not just in Antarctica, but it's a big challenge to do field work at sea, because there's not a hardware store down the road. If you don't have everything you need, you're going to have issues. So part of the problem is to make sure you've thought things out very well. You've taking the best equipment. You have the right people to solve the problems. That's the part I find challenging. I've always enjoyed that, and I've always felt like that's something I do well. I mean, think in advance about what instrumentation is needed, what equipment's needed, who are the best people, and then trying to make all that work. It's like a professional football team.
Yep.
You know, you need good running backs and you need big linemen, but you also need some good coaching. You need to make sure those people function as a unit, and that's kind of very similar to doing science.
So tell me something. You solve the problem before you leave. Tell me something more about this, solving the problem before you leave. What do you mean by that?
Well, not the scientific problem, but solving the problems of how you're going to collect the data that you need, you know, to address the problem. I mean, a solution to the problem is pretty unpredictable, maybe. We have hypotheses, you know. We always say, well, we think we'll collect these data and this will be the observation. But as scientists, we don't allow ourselves to become biased by that hypothesis. That's just the way science is driven. It's called hypothesis-driven science. So we don't have anything at stake here, and we try to teach our students the same process. Okay, you put forth a hypothesis or several hypotheses. You go to test those hypotheses, but you remain open-minded and willing to change those hypotheses. So you don't solve the problem. What you do, I guess what I meant to say there, is you solve the problem of getting the right people, getting the right equipment, going to the right place to solve the problem. And that's the first challenge. Then once you've gotten there, the next challenge is being successful in collecting the data that you need in this very hostile environment. And finally, when you've done that, then you have the data. Then you solve the problem, or you hope to solve the problem.
And now this fundamental question about the goal of your research, especially for you, with all of your experience and your many field campaigns on research vessels in along the coast in Antarctica. What is the core of the goal of the things that you research on?
Fundamentally, I think the primary motivation right now, not just for me, but for a whole team of scientists that I interact with. There's a group called the West Antarctic Ice Sheet Community that I'm a part of. And that community includes physical oceanographers, biologists, geologists, glaciologists, a whole suite of people who come together once a year. We meet at some place in the States, but it's an international group. And we sort of compare our data sets and talk about some of the big issues. The big issue our community right now, this West Antarctic Ice Sheet community, is trying to understand better is we know that the ice sheet, particularly the West Antarctic Ice Sheet, which is the part of the Antarctic Ice Sheet that is grounded below sea level, seems to be changing at what must be an unprecedented rate. Now, how do I know it's an unprecedented rate? Well, you know, you measure from space, you measure the rate at which the glaciers are retreating and things of this sort. And then you do calculations and you say, well, if the ice had been retreating at this rate for the last 1,000 years, there wouldn't be any more ice there. It would have drained away. So clearly, the rate at which the ice is draining today is unprecedented. Now, does that mean that it's been really changing radically in the last 20 years, or has it been slowly ramping up? I mean, what's been, what do we mean by unprecedented? The fundamental reason we want to address that is because we know the ice sheet is showing signs of instability. By that, I mean that from space, using satellites primarily, we can see that the ice sheet is getting thinner. And measurably thinner. Over periods of years, it's getting thinner. Now, the important thing about the West Antarctic Ice Sheet is it's grounded well below sea level. And so, as the ice gets thinner, eventually it'll float, right? And so, right now, there are locations in Antarctica where the ice sheet is getting thin enough that it's close to what's called the buoyancy limits, meaning it'll start to float off the seafloor. The seafloor in Antarctica tends to be very rugged, very irregular. So in some locations where the ice begins to float off the seafloor, where it will retreat to could be much, much deeper. So the rate of retreat could actually accelerate through time. So there are a lot of variables that control how the ice behaves and how fast it retreats. But ultimately, the melting of the ice, the water that's created by the melting of the ice, goes into the oceans and raises sea level. So one of the big concerns, there are a number of concerns about the ice, loss of ice, but the biggest concern, one we hear most about, is sea level rise and how the ice is contributing to sea level rise.
I see. So that is one of the main goals, to collect the data. And did you always have the same goals, or along your career you have changed those, or it depends simply by the database that you are investigating?
Oh, my goals have changed radically in the time I've been involved in
Antarctica. What were your very first goals?
Well, I think my very first goals, when I first went to Antarctica, I was a student. This is 1970, so, yeah, almost 50 years. And back then, we were asking questions that seem very naive today, like, well, was the Antarctic ice sheet ever bigger? We knew the Northern Hemisphere ice sheets were bigger and that the ice sheets advanced down into the Midwestern states, etc. But really, there were actually people who would argue that the Antarctic ice sheet was pretty well contained by the ocean that surrounds it. And so there was a lot of debate about whether the ice sheet actually got bigger and smaller. You know, what its contribution to sea level was, for example, what its contribution to ocean circulation, things of that nature. And so at that time, we knew very little. So we began collecting data back in the 70s that was just basic, very basic data, you know, like what do the sediments look like that are out there on the seafloor?
I bet. I mean, you really had the sense of the discovery.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I mean, when I went, my first research cruise was to the Weddell Sea, one of the larger seas in Antarctica. And when I got ready to leave to go there, my advisor came into my office one day and handed me a paper and said, you need to read this paper. This is one of the few papers ever written on the Weddell Sea. Turned out it was a paper from the Shackleton expedition in the early 1900s. And they had made some very interesting observations during that expedition. So that talk about the sense of discovery is when you're reading papers that are 100 years, you know, almost 100 years older, that, you know, were written 100 years before, almost a century before you go on this cruise. So I think the first 10 years I was involved in Antarctica, even some degree the first 20, there was that feeling of exploration, you know, of going down, gathering knowledge, not really having enough knowledge to put together any great hypotheses, just let's go find out what's there kind of thing.
Yeah, I love the pleasure of exploration.
Absolutely.
Just per se.
Yes.
Nothing else, nothing more than the pleasure of exploration.
Absolutely. And then that was followed by maybe a decade of you know, it's kind of interesting that back in the late 80s, there was a lot of discussion about oil and gas in Antarctica. And so a lot of the various nations that participate in Antarctic research were actually sending down geophysical vessels to collect seismic data to assess oil and gas potential of some of the basins in Antarctica. And so all of us kind of got caught up in that because there was this knowledge that ultimately a decision was going to have to be made about what to do about oil and gas and other mineral resources in Antarctica. So even in the U.S., there was a lot of pressure to say, okay, well, we need to make knowledgeable decisions, which means we need to know what's there. So I got caught up in that with a lot of other people because I do a lot of geophysics. So there was about a 10-year period there where we were collecting a lot of seismic data and assessing potential oil and gas, you know. And then Clinton suddenly signed the Minerals Protocol that says, okay, along with the other countries, and SCAR countries, it said, regardless of whether there's oil and gas and other mineral reserves in Antarctica, it's hands off. There's not going to be any exploration of those resources. So suddenly the scientific community is told, okay, guys, go do something else. We no longer need to do this assessment. In fact, there was some desire not to do it, not to know, so to speak. And that was, you know, I was glad to see that, actually, because I was always had this desire to look at more academic types of things and, you know, it kind of provided an opportunity to refocus our research. Well, that was about the same time that we began to realize that the Earth was changing, the Earth's climate was changing, and that the ice sheets were, in fact, getting smaller, and began to, you know, satellites were collecting better data by the 90s and 2000s. And so suddenly there was tremendous shift in the science community, the Antarctic polar science community, to say, well, we really need to spend our time looking at how these ice sheets are behaving, how fast they're changing, etc. And so that was a pretty radical shift for me. But that's
and the radical shift was affected by a political decision.
Absolutely.
In the political decision, was it affected by whom?
Well, the decision was made by the SCAR countries, by the participants in, you know, the Antarctic protocol. And so they met, and this wasn't just President Clinton that signed some, you know, protocol, but it was actually the SCAR nations that met over days and discussed, you know, what to do about mineral and oil and gas reserves in Antarctica, were, if they indeed were there.
How is it the situation today politically in Antarctica?
Today, most of us don't talk much about minerals and oil and gas in Antarctica. You know, we have other issues to deal with. The scientific community's moved pretty much away from that endeavor. The oil and gas industry, the minerals industry, has been told, hands off, guys. You know, you can't send your industry research vessels, geophysical vessels, to Antarctica. That's not acceptable. You can't harvest certain biological resources. That's not acceptable. And so just like, you know, whales and seals and other things that have been placed off limits, oil and gas been placed off limits. That's actually freed the scientific community up to some degree from this diversion we had focusing on oil and gas and other minerals.
I see. So that what you are telling us, it resembles to me an analogy of what's happening now with the climate change, where most of the scientific community has shifted and the attention has gone in to try to solve this problem. Actually, a few days ago, it came out, the fourth National Climate Assessment, and that demonstrate that probably in 20 years from now, somebody sitting in your chair would say, well, during those years, most of the community was really shifted by political elements into study that specific subject of matter, right?
Absolutely. I mean, I think, you know, the scientific community, there's been a lot of, you know, discussion about this, and people have even said, well, the whole global climate change is just a hoax. We know one of those people, right? It's been fabricated by the scientific community. Well, that's the most ludicrous thing you've ever heard if you're a scientist, because we're not trained to pull off some sort of a great hoax. In fact, the very nature of scientists is to debate and argue, you know, over issues. That's what we do, and that's how we move the science forward. So to even try to imagine a situation where thousands of scientists would come together in some place and say, okay, we're all going to start promoting this global climate change thing because that's going to get us more money, is absolutely ludicrous. And I think most scientists, myself included, actually resent that, because it's sort of saying, well, we're not a very ethical community, that we're driven by whatever happens to be popular at the time. And that's certainly not the case. Most scientists are driven by science, you know, not some political agenda. It was the data, you know, that was gathered during the first, you know, international, you know, efforts to look at evidence for global climate change that told us this is a very real, and it's happening at time frames that much faster than we suspected. And if you look at the last 20 years since the intergovernmental panel, international governmental panels have been convened, and there have been a number of them, I think if we've learned anything, it's that processes that are driving our climate and feedbacks from having climate change on ice sheets and other things is happening at a rate beyond what we predicted.
Before moving to the relationship between this topic of climate change and your main database of studies in Antarctica and the Gulf Coast, I would like to ask you something about the critical thinking or the critical mass, because you mentioned now that hundreds of thousands of scientists, they come together, they analyze data, they come up with a solution. Do you see the critical mass evolving, changing along your path, along your career? It works always the same way, the critical thinking and the critical mass?
I think the scientific approach has been around for centuries. You know, we don't do things much differently from what our forefathers in science did. I mean, they also had a sort of a hypothesis-driven scientific approach. They asked much different questions, much more basic questions back then, but science has pretty much remained the same. Certainly has in my 50 years of doing it, and I think for arguably for a couple of centuries at least, the methodology, you know, the approach to doing science has remained pretty much the same. And the way we train future scientists has remained the same. I think scientific ethics has always been very much the same. It's very easy to get ousted from the scientific community if you publish a paper where you've doctored the data, falsified the data. I mean, the ramifications of that are severe. And so if you're, let's say, a denier of some aspect of global climate change, and so you doctor up a little data and you publish a paper and you say, well, it really didn't, you know, this, we don't have to worry this. If you're discovered, you know, the ramifications can be quite severe. You know, you can end your career in that way. But that happens very rarely, because I think most scientists, you know, become scientists because they really have this curiosity to solve problems, and not to promote some political agenda. You know, and so I think that's a very important thing, and that's why I think most scientists really resent having people say, especially prominent people say, this is a fabrication. This is all a hoax. That's being pulled off by scientists, you know, to get more money or to have some agenda or whatever. That's questioning our basic fundamental ethics in the sciences.
So, you mentioned we both did together the link between Antarctica and the climate change. So, do you want to link diving deeper into the argument of the things that you studied today, even if you are officially retired, and the things that you are doing in Antarctica, the research that is going on, and the relationship with the climate change, or if you will, the sea level rise?
Yeah, well, and the fact that, by the way, that I'm retired, I've only been retired about 3 or 4 months now, and I'm still, but it hasn't, nothing's changed. The day I stopped getting paychecks Rice,
intellectually hasn't changed.
In no way detracted from my scientific curiosity or desire to do science. And I hope I have that curiosity, and I'm doing science the rest of my life. So most scientists, you know, really love what they do. And so to say, well, I'm retired, may sound like, well, you know, you're out of it now, but you never really are out of it. And I still do research. I still have postdocs that do research. And in fact, I have more time to do research now than I did when I was teaching.
Correct.
And attending faculty meetings and doing other things. So, you know, I've been very fortunate to have spent my career at Rice, where they're very lenient and promote us doing science and training good students and having good quality students. But let's you know, get back to this issue of Antarctica and its role in global climate change. And, you know, one thing people I get really kind of tired of nowadays, and always are trying to a message I'm always trying to get out there is that global climate change is not something that is being predicted. It is something that we are living with today. And so people have argued that the wildfires in California are related to global climate change, and probably is. And the fact that we may not understand that connection quite well doesn't mean it's not connected. Again, it's a hypothesis that maybe it's beyond the hypothesis stage, but it's something we certainly need to look into. And or the fact that we have more hurricanes than anyone can remember in the Pacific, hurricanes going off Hawaii, for Pete's sake, are stronger hurricanes in the Caribbean and the Gulf that are causing far more damage than in the past. These are not coincidences. This is very real. So we are observing our climate, the impacts of climate change, even now. So we're not talking about predictions. What I do is sea level rise and how that's impacted by changes in ice sheets. I always like to point out that if you melt the Antarctic ice sheet, you raise sea level about 200 feet. That's a lot of sea level. Now, that's not going to happen anytime in the next few million years. But the point I'm trying to make is that we don't have to change a lot in Antarctica, or to some degree Greenland. You don't really have to change a lot of the size of the Antarctic ice sheet to have a very significant impact on the rate of sea level rise. We are currently, if we measure the rate of sea level rise along the Gulf Coast using tide gauges, which is one of the better ways of doing it, but we can do it from space now too with satellites. The current rate of rise is about 3 millimeters per year, just a little over an eighth of an inch, between an eighth and a quarter of an inch. That doesn't seem like a lot, and a lot of people say, well, that's not a lot. I don't have to worry about this for 100 years. I'll be dead and gone before sea level gets up to my knees on the beach. But what's important to realize is that the rate of change is what's important in terms of, for example, how stable barrier islands are, which make up 80% of our coast here in Texas. Not the magnitude, but the rate is what's affecting barriers. The rate of change in the Gulf of Mexico, as measured from tide gauge records, is again about 3 millimeters per year. If we go back and look at the geological records of sea level change, if go back several thousand years, the average rate of rise over the last 2,000 years has been about a half a millimeter per year. So the current rate is 6 times faster than the long-term rate. And that rate, acceleration in sea level rise took place in the last century, since we've been making these measurements. Is that fortuitous that sea level would increase 6 times, the rate of rise would increase 6 times? If we go back in geological time to when the sea level was rising here in the Gulf of Mexico as fast as it is today, we have to go back 7,000 years. And if we go back 7,000 years, and geologists can do that, we can hop in our time machine and go back and see, how was the Gulf Coast evolving 7,000 years ago? Well, it was a really different world, you know. And a lot of people say, well, climate's always changed. Big deal. Climate's always changed. Well, sure, climate's always changed. Sea level's going up and down hundreds of feet. But quite frankly, I wouldn't want to have been living along the coast 7,000 years ago.
Yeah, especially putting on the plate the economic factor, right? So we are always reasoning in an anthropocentric way. And the people that we elect and the 4 governments, they also do that. It's not really an environmental-centric thought, this one. So we always know that there are trillions of dollars in the coastal infrastructures, and that is an important factor to take care of that goes beyond the science. But if this is something that we try to do here at Mini Geology many times, to try to build those bridges and do not leave isolated different groups of the community. So going beyond the science and trying to understand the policymakers, our politicians and industry, which respond to demand of the population, is something that we have to do. In fact, I also know that you are involved in outreach, and I think that we doing here at Mini Geology is a very important thing that we geologists don't do that well. We love so much our disciplines that we don't deserve, we don't give much time to allow the others understand what we do. So do you want to talk a little bit about your outreach efforts and the importance of communicating better about the things that we do?
Sure. I think, you know, as scientists, we really struggle to try to get information out there to the public that basically just discusses the changes that are in fact happening and tries to, you know, separate out things like wildfires or these related to global climate change and how and things of that, you know, and the fact that there's a lot that still needs to be understood in that area versus sea level rise, where actually we've come a long ways in the last 20 years. We know, for example, if we take the oceans are heating up, and so when you heat water, it expands. And so that's a component of the sea level rise, just the warming of the oceans. And we can measure that. We've been measuring the temperature of the oceans for a century now. And if we take those measurements, they show the oceans have been getting progressively warmer for the last century. If we calculate the amount of expansion that should have occurred as a result of simple heating of the oceans, we come up with about 2 millimeters per year increase in sea level in the last century from these observations. This is not theory. This is just simple observation. And so that leaves us another millimeter or so, and that's coming from glaciers. And we know glaciers are retreating. 89% of the glaciers in the world, now we're talking about smaller glaciers, are retreating. So if you want to go to Glacier National Park, you need to do so in the next decade or so, because those glaciers are getting smaller. And there are a lot of glaciers that you used to be able to hike onto that you can't hike onto anymore. The glaciers of the world are, in fact, getting smaller. This is not scientific, you know, hypothesis or prediction or whatever. This is fact. We now know, and only in the last decade really know well, that the ice sheets are getting smaller, because only in the last decade have we developed this instrumentation, in this case not to image the seafloor, but to look down from space at the surface of the ice sheet and see very small changes in the height of the ice sheet that we couldn't see 10 or 15 years ago, that are telling us, the ice sheet is getting thinner. And it's getting thinner much faster than we thought. And in some cases, it's getting thinner at a rate that has to be unprecedented again. So as scientists, we try always to communicate that to the public, but it doesn't always get out there. And it's really hard to communicate it to policymakers. I mean, I'm sorry, but to be quite frank, you know, it's really hard to promote science with policymakers. They often look for quick decisions that can be, solutions that can be solved within a 4-year term of office.
Unless the policymakers, they are scientists. And sometimes we should maybe think about our community and encourage some of us, the ones that are more skilled, to go into politics and become one of those.
That's a great thing, and it does happen occasionally, but it's fairly rare. And of course, some of the larger scientific societies, like the American Geophysical Union, have their they have postdoctoral positions where these people actually go to Washington and serve as apprentices, you know, for a year or two in Washington, trying to help convey the science to the policymakers. But it's a two-way road. I'm often told, well, the scientists aren't doing enough to reach out to the policymakers. I would argue it's a two-way road. And policymakers need to do more to reach out to the scientist. I mean, I think scientists, I look at what's happening today in our field, and there's a much greater effort in the last 10 years for scientists to reach out to policymakers, try to get that information out there. But the process is happening too slowly for us to educate these people fast enough to make the kinds of rapid changes in the policies that are going to be needed to help us prepare the next generation and generation after that for the future they're going to live with.
Talking about generation, John, what is your legacy? What do you leave behind? And we already know that you're still working. That's clear.
Well, I guess I can plug my book. I've got a book out. Actually, I published it 10 years ago. It's called The Formation and Future of the Upper Texas Coast. And it talks about various sort of things we've been talking about, you know, how coasts are responding to sea level rise and the scientific evidence to show that the rate at which our coast is changing today is much faster than it was 100 years ago because of this acceleration sea level rise, but some other factors as well.
Did you think while you were writing the book that that was going to be your legacy, or you discovered afterwards that once you wrote the book, that was your legacy?
Well, it wasn't intended to be necessarily my legacy. It was intended really to get the science out to the non-science community and to policymakers. Actually, when I wrote that book, I sort of wrote it for teachers. My mother was a science teacher, and so I sort of always had this appreciation for how important it is to get new data, new scientific observation out to teachers, because they're the ones that are going to get that information out to the next generation. Okay. People are going to have to deal with these problems.
I really see now and understand a bit more your mindset, because that is why you go on into the basic concepts. If you want to communicate with teachers, you communicate the basic concept, the very important things, but that they are simple. And that is also the way to apply them, because the teachers, then they are a mean, they're a vehicle, they're a pipe to instruct all the next generation.
That's right. That's right. I think that's the way we solve, to some degree, our problem is by educating, you know, the next generations. And I think we're doing a much better job of that. I have grandkids that are, you know, pre-teenagers, and except for one of them, she just turned to a teenager. But I'm very impressed with the discussions I'm able to carry on with them and the knowledge that they have, not from me, but from their teachers and their school about, you know, processes or the climate change. They're pretty well tuned in, you know, to some of these changes, and that's what it's going to take. We simply cannot continue down the path of saying, Earth's climate's always changed, big deal. Well, yeah, but I don't want to live in some of the times when Earth's climate was at one extreme or the other. When it was too cold, it was covered in ice. When it was too hot, you couldn't live here. So it is true that Earth's climate has changed, but we need to instruct people or educate people about what that really means.
So now that we parents in general, with or without great education, we are more educated than the previous generations. We probably have, as parents, the responsibility to teach these things to our kids, even without expecting the teachers to do it. So that is probably something else that we should communicate.
Absolutely. Absolutely. I think it's important as parents and grandparents to have these discussions with our children, with our grandkids, to educate them, not to scare them, although it's kind of scary. The real reality is pretty scary. But I think it's very important for us to educate, you know, our children, grandchildren about the realities of global climate change, the impacts, and that, and maybe to have the conversation, okay, we just had these serious, horrible wildfires in California. We've seen unprecedented number of hurricanes in the Pacific Ocean this year. We've seen huge, unprecedented magnitudes of storms in the Caribbean and the Gulf of Mexico the last few years. Is this related to changing? Is this not evidence that climate change? I think you can have those conversations with a 12-year-old or a 13-year-old And, you know, at least ask the questions and encourage them to seek out the answers. Ask their teachers, you know, whatever they need to do to seek out that information.
John, I would like to leave you this a couple of minutes for you to talk with the students, and I would like to finish with something very practical and pragmatical. Having you in here, I would like you to talk with them and give them suggestions to geologists, students that they are now in the university, first year or last year, and suggesting them how to behave, what to study, where to invest their time. And with that, I would like to thank you, John Anderson, professor from Rice University. I really, really enjoy this chat with you. But now, please, you have the open mic to talk with them.
Oh, okay. Well, I guess the message I'd like to convey to all students, whether they be grammar school, high school, or is that science is fun. It can be great fun, but that perhaps more importantly, you can solve some really important problems. And so when you're kind of looking at careers at whatever age, you know, high school, whatever, and science is something that you think you might be interested in at least pursuing, realize that there are a lot of really important problems that have to be solved, and you can contribute to solving those problems. I think that it's important to also realize that there's going to be a lot of frustration and along the way. It's not an easy path to follow, but it's a very rewarding one. And So I encourage you to think about careers in science, all of you. And for those of you that are, since this is mini geology, geology is a great science to solve some of these problems. Most people don't, you know, I get people all the time, oh, you're a geologist, so you look for oil. No, I don't look for oil. Well, do you look at rocks? No, I don't look at rocks. You know, there's a lot of geology that is not looking at rocks or looking for oil and gas or looking for minerals. In fact, there are a lot of geologists that are trying to look at these problems and have some unique tools to bring to bear. The ability to look at processes happening over longer time spans than we can typically measure. So it's a lot of fun.
Thank you very much, John. This was Mini Geology with Daniel Minizini, your inquisitive geologist. You can listen to this again in minigeology.com, a YouTube channel, or you can write me at minigeology@gmail.com. Thank you very much. Bye, John.
Bye-bye. Enjoyed it.